preparing for my Sundays, I try to do my Vulcan mind meld on everybody. And one of the things, you know, we've been here, I've been here now for almost 7 months, it'll be, and I am always overwhelmed with how your soul purpose can be the most blessed thing that happens to you and the most challenging thing that happens to you. And I'm of course reminded of Jesus. When Jesus said, "I'll go, I'll do it, let me take it on." And he started his ministry by being baptized in the water by John the Baptist. Water. Whenever I live on Lake Wylie, and so whenever I go over the bridge of Lake Wylie, I remember that water is a cleanser. Water also helps us to release emotion. And so if I am roiling with emotion, and you know, I'm half Italian, I'm very emotional. And it's not very passionate, though. And so a lot of times, though, that passion can kind of tip and I might get annoyed
a little bit.
So when I go over that bridge every time, and fortunately I go over it at least twice a day, I spiral from my soul star, this energy, to please take away any emotions that need to be transmuted into positive energy and take them into the water and let the water cleanse me and bring me back up to that part of me that is aligned with God in my soul. But remember, when Jesus said yes, he also was then visited by challenges. Many challenges. And as we say yes to the sole purpose of our group, as we say yes to the sole purpose of ourselves, do not expect it to be a rose-strewn path. And I have to remind myself about this. Because there's two levels of looking for at challenges. One is personality, and the personality can say, "Oh, this is too hard. I am not doing this anymore." Soul says, "Yes, my child, you are honing your soul. You are going through this change and transformation because you have to get rid of all of the dross that is keeping you from knowing your perfection in the eyes of your Creator, Father, Mother, God." And we can move mountains. Let's start by moving that burnout there a little bit, because the NC Dodge decided to put a little mountain in front of our place. But this is, you know, we have a lot of obstacles. We have some challenges. But we're going to talk about our individual self today. Next week is about our group and where we're going. But this week is about you. Really, it's all about you, isn't it? Now, when I first started to do public speaking, one of my coaches used to say, "Remember, it's not about you, it's about them." And I beg to differ. It is about me. Because if I'm not present, if I'm not balanced, if I'm not passionate about what I'm doing, the other people are getting nothing. So it is about us. It is about you. It is about me. Because me and you, we're one. Me and you, we're connected. So whatever I do reflects on you, and whatever you do reflects on me. And whatever we do reflects on the I'm going to remind us something that Marianne Williamson said. A lot of people think that somebody else said this, but it was Marianne Williamson in A Return to Love. You've heard this, but I'm going to remind us. Our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. It is our light, not our darkness, that most frightens us. Now think about this. When we have an amazing amount of light, our shadow is bigger. And why is that? Because we need to look through the glass darkly and see that that is not us. We need to shatter the darkness by being not just light, but love. Love will shatter that darkness. We ask ourselves, who am I to be brilliant, gorgeous, talented, and fabulous? Actually, who are you not to be? You are a child of God. Your playing small doesn't serve the world. There is nothing enlightened about shrinking so that other people won't feel insecure around you. Think about you in your jobs. Do you shine? But do you shine from your heart, not your ego? We are all meant to shine as children do. We are born to make manifest the glory of God within us. It's not just in some of us, it's in everyone. And as we let our own light shine, we unconsciously give other people permission to do the same. As we are liberated from our own fear, our presence automatically liberates others. As we are liberated from our own fear, our presence automatically liberates others. Automatically. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well. So what do we have to fear? I just watched most of them, and they're still on my DVR, the whole series on the Roosevelts. Do you realize what those two men overcame as children? They were not expected to live, much less be the two of the most influential presidents we've ever had in our country. Roosevelt, Teddy certainly wasn't expected to live past a certain age. And look what they did for our country. And who said, which one of them said, we have nothing to fear but fear itself?
Franklin.
During one of the most horrific wars this world has ever seen. Now, we're surrounded by a whole lot of things that we could sink into fear and frustration about. Yesterday, I only had one wedding, okay? And I was like, moseying around today, I'm working on my sermon, I'm working on this, I'm doing that. So left in plenty of time because it was a big wedding and I knew I needed to be there. At least I wanted to be there 45 minutes ahead of time. So I left. It was only at the foundation of the Carolinas. It's about a 20-minute drive for me. But I left an hour and a half ahead of time. I pull on to 77. Complete stop. I'm going, oh, this is interesting. And then as I turn the corner towards Tivola, I'm thinking, oh, that's going all the way downtown. I better get off at Tivola and go down Tryon. Pull on Tryon, complete stop. There's a funeral procession. And I can, the car's as far as the eye can see. I'm going, what's this about? Well, I decided it was about me taking control of my life. So there was one car in front of me. The funeral procession was on that side. I was on this side. There was only one car ahead of me. Stopped. I know out of respect. But I get out of my car. And the reverend goes over the median and gets to the policeman's car and go, could you roll down your window, please? Hi, I'm a minister. I have a wedding. Would you mind if I went ahead and went? And he goes, what side are you on? I said, that side. He goes, you can go. I said, thank you. He goes, just tell that guy to get out of your way. And I said, hello, guy. Could you please get out of my way? He was mad at me. He was not going to move. Because he didn't hear me say, please. And I did. I always say, please. I said, sir, I did say, please. He said, you just said, get out of my way. I said, actually, I did not say that at all. I said, please, for the love of God, I'm a minister. I understand the respect that you were showing, and I honor you for it, but I need to get down. He wasn't going to move. So I just did one of my, Dad, would you get him out of my way? And then he relented and moved. And what was interesting was the whole line behind him went with him because they wanted to move too. I mean, there's just so much respect, right? And so I get downtown and I can't find a parking place. I go over to, I don't go to Hearst Tower. I went over to the across the street, the hotel. And I finally, as I'm rolling around, because I have rock star parking, I have, from an accident I had, I have handicapped parking, so I can, there wasn't any available. I was like, what the heck, it's a Saturday. So I drive down the corner and someone just pulling out of a handicapped space. Thank you, Jesus. We're going good here. Three's a charm. I get in, smooth as ice, until I get to pronouncing the bride's name. They are Korean. Now, I've been practicing for 2 days her middle name. Her first name is Lisa, and her last name is Kim. Easy peasy, right? Her middle name was Hyunsu. I get to Hyunsu, and I flub it up incredibly. Why did I flub it up? Because I was afraid of doing it wrong. God forbid I should do something wrong, right? Miss recovering perfectionist that I am. However, she was getting ready to cry. He was already crying. It gave us a comical moment. And I looked up and I said, you know, I've been practicing that for 2 days. Everybody laughed. And that is when I remember we must get over ourselves. We learn by being imperfect as we strive for perfection. If we focus on perfection, we ain't never going to get anything done. Now, the second time I had to do it, I said it correctly because I had let go of it. At that point, I already flubbed it up, right? And this is exactly what it's like when we're working with our soul purpose. We are, look down, is everybody still in physical form? Oh, yeah. We're not perfect yet. We're still choosing to work on ourselves. We're still choosing to outpicture an aspect of God, the aspect that Father, Mother, God gave us to do. How do we know what God gave us to do? How do we know? We feel like a teenager waiting to be picked up. Teenage girl, I can only speak to a teenage girl, waiting to be picked up by our first love on a date. We get this little fluttery feeling, anticipation, this, oh gosh, I can't wait for him to get here. When I get those feelings, I know that my soul is in alignment with my desire nature. I know when I am doing the right thing because I get excited, I get passionate, and ain't nothing gonna stop me from doing it. You want to put a roadblock in front of me? I'll talk directly to the officer in charge. Now, if he had said no, I don't know what I would have done. I guess I would have just taken a deep breath and said, God bless you, and walked away. I hope I would have said that. But see, this is what we are constantly doing every minute of our waking day, is we are saying, do we go right or do we go left? Do we go straight or do we take a couple steps back and go another direction? So no one can call us insane. Or do we do it just one more time and it happens? Remember the Buddhist monk who decided that he wanted to be enlightened just like Buddha. So he went under the Bodhi tree and he began to meditate, waiting for enlightenment to come down and down. And he meditates, and enlightenment is coming down and down. And he meditates, and he meditates. And about the third week, he was, well, I'm not going to do this anymore. It's not going to happen. And it was just getting ready to hit his head. And he was just getting ready to be enlightened. Do you deny yourself enlightenment because you give up too soon? I don't know. But I know that I'm going to try not to do that anymore. See, I did that a few years ago when I disbanded New Directions. Three times we moved and three times the places closed. And I thought, this is the third time. I guess the universe is trying to tell me something. Was it? Yeah, it was saying take a rest because we got another one waiting for you down the road. And we want to make good and sure that you are so ready to do your soul work again.
so ready that nothing is going to deter you from realizing the perfection of the place we are giving you. The perfection of the people that are there already and the people that are coming. This is what gets me out of bed in the morning. This is what I know is my soul's purpose, is to be with you. And I am so sure of this that I'm going to probably start crying again. You know, that song, we are here for a higher purpose, not just in this group, but on this plane. What is that higher purpose? To love, to be loved, and to remember ye are gods. That's what we're here for. And anything that is less than godlike, allow it to go away. Slip away. You know the old adage, what would Jesus do? What would Jesus do? Of course, if I was Jesus last night, I would have departed the cars and gone straight in. But you know, I'm not there yet. I'm not there yet. But they did go. Because I asked. How many times do you think you could do something by yourself? How many times do you think you are going to show weakness by asking for help? This is really important for us as we grow and into new places and new ways and new ideas and new opportunities that we may not be quite sure about. You know, we each need a person. I have a person. That person knows who it is that I go to. And I say, actually, I have several persons. One is not in this country. And thank goodness for, you know, no rate long distance. And I think even when they do give me advice sometimes, I still make up my own mind, because I'm an independent cuss. So when we are searching and looking at what God wants us to do, what is our sole purpose? Look very carefully at what God gave you to do. And then remember what Jesus said to the Father. I'll do it! No problem. I can do this. I can do this. And then we need to remember what our soul is doing 24/7. Our soul is meditating on our plan and our purpose. So when we align ourselves with the soul, we open to our soul purpose by the higher self being able to stream the knowledge down to us, so that we can begin to hear with a still small voice. Because it's there, it's everywhere, but sometimes we get in our own way. So we must put ourselves in posture at least once a day to know what the soul knows, to know what our soul knows. Because when we do that, we become magnificent beings of manifestation. No obstacle will be in our way. When we bring it here and we know this is mine to do, get out of the way, world. This is what my father and mother just gave me to do for this lifetime, and I'm going to do it. Because the next lifetime, I'm going to do something even more. So let me do this now. Because otherwise, I may have to do this over again. I don't want to do that again. I have a thing to do now. I'm going to do it now. And so allow the Spirit to be here to push the obstacles out of the way for you. For you. You don't have to do it alone. You have an amazing team headed by your soul, contributed to by your angels and your guides and your teachers on the inner planes, who then magnetize to you your teachers and your guides and your friends and support system on the physical plane. I forget sometimes I'm not supposed to do it alone. I was reminded about that when I went to physical therapy for my shoulder last week. You don't have to shoulder it all by yourself. You call on your guides and your teachers, and you put yourself in position and posture, and you listen, and you allow, and then you let go and let it happen. But that's the conscious part. That's where you are in control. You have to allow it to happen. You have to put yourself in posture. You have to ask for the help to come, and then let it go and let it do what it will. What it will, and not judge it. Because as you look back on your life and you see the obstacles, you see the challenges, you see the quote-unquote problems that happened, they weren't really anything except open yourselves to the next opportunity. And you're still here, so you didn't die. And if you died, so what? You're releasing the physical body to be with your Father, Mother in heaven. There's nothing to fear but fear itself. We are the ones we've been waiting for. And so it is. And now, let us prepare for meditation. Uncross, close your eyes, and allow yourself to put your hands, palms up on your lap or your thighs or your knees. And we take a deep, deep breath in, giving our bodies the mental command to relax, release, let go. Breathing in fresh, vibrant energy. Breathing out any stale, used up energy. Breathing in the power and passion of God, and breathing out that which no longer serves us. And we affirm now that we are going to co-create our future by using the power of our mind and our soul, bringing them together. And so we begin by connecting with our soul star, about 6 or 8 inches above our heads. We see this ball of golden white light. Vibrant, shining. We feel it shining upon us. We can even feel the cosmic electricity that is its core. And we bring down a stream of light from our soul star. And we direct it down the left side of our heads and begin to wrap it like a turban of light from the left to the right, and continue wrapping it until you feel yourself expand, your consciousness becoming larger and larger. Breathe. And now bring a stream of light down from your soul star again, this time on the right side, wrapping it from the right to the left until you have felt that you are finished and you have expanded out and up even more. You have put on the helmet of the Lord, the light of high consciousness. After you feel that you have wrapped the light fully, take another stream of energy through the helmet of the Lord
and bring it down the back of your head, behind your neck, and lay the tail of life behind your heart. You have brought now the energy of the soul, enclosing the head centers and anchored in the heart, truly connecting heart with mind, so that you too may thinketh in the heart and love with the mind. And from this point of connectedness, affirm, I am the soul, and also love am I. Above all else, I am both will and fixed desire. My will is now to lift the lower self into the light divine. That light am I. Therefore, I must descend to where the lower self awaits my coming. That which desires to lift and that which cries for lifting are now at one. Such is my will. And now we focus again in the middle of our minds, our third eye, and we see as a little ball of golden light appears. And we watch now as the light expands even more until it covers the entire inner vision of our minds. And we see within this light a beautiful temple. There is a garden that surrounds this temple, and a body of water that flows through the garden. Look again at the temple, and we see it is filled with golden light. And we are here. For we have been brought here together by the power and in the presence of the divine creator of all that is. And we now invite our angel to join us here. At the center of this light, God's most beautiful angel, however it appears to us. And we see our soul relax into the arms of God, supported by our angel. And from the arms of God, the heart of God, our own hearts, we see a golden cord that connects us to all of life, that connects us to our life. And as we sit resting in the arms of God, supported by our angel, we see our heart center now transmuting any negative emotional feelings we have for this current life into positive, loving feeling. Breathe in the love of God and exhale anything that's keeping us from knowing our perfection. And now inhale. This time visualizing an energy rising from your heart to your head. And in the middle of your head, dedicate your energy to helping others in some way as service to humanity. And ask God to show you what is mine to do. Dear Lord, show me, make clear my purpose at this moment in time? We go into the silence with this question, what is mine to do? And we listen. Now take a breath, knowing that bits of wisdom, streams of knowledge will continue to come to you. And watch your dreams, for that is where God speaks to us when our personalities get out of the way. And take this love and this light and this power and begin to direct it to some part of the world that you would bless with your energy of love and healing. See a stream of light go from your heart to this place and to other places that might come to your mind. And love them. Heal them. They too are your family. And now let us feel gratitude for the work that we are so privileged to be a part of. And take a breath and put your hands together, palm to palm in front of your heart, as we say together the Hindu word for peace. Shanti, 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 may peace prevail on earth. Thank you, Father, Mother, God. And so it is. Breathe. Get settled for a moment, and I'm being guided to just have you look at each other. Remember that our eyes are the window of our soul. And acknowledge each other. Love each other. Feel gratitude for one another. And so it is. And now, are we centered? Are we back? Feeling yourself in the physical world.